Good morning, students. So today we are going to study about cell wall. In my previous lectures, I have taught you about the fluid mosaic model of the plasma membrane and the different type of transport, such as active transport, passive transport, and a special type of transport which is known as a facilitated diffusion in case of plasma membrane. We have also studied about the structure of ribosomes, inclusion bodies. So in today's topic, we are going to study about a cell wall. As we all know, students, whenever we have to differentiate between plant cell and animal cell, so our first point is that plant cell always has an outermost boundary, and that is rigid and tough, and it is actually its cell wall. And this cell wall, it is not present in case of animal cells. Here the outermost boundary consists of a membrane, which is known as cell membrane or plasma membrane. So today I am going to tell you more about this cell wall and its function. As we know that plants, they are stationary in their habitat. They cannot move from their habitats. So they have to face so many type of mechanical and chemical stresses. That's why these plant cells, they have a rigid and tough structure as its outermost boundary, and this is known as the cell wall. So this cell wall, when the plant cell is in its younger stage, then the cell wall which first originate in the plant cell, it is known as the primary cell wall. But this primary cell wall is short-lived and it stay in the cell for some time. And later it is replaced by another new cell wall, and that cell wall grows towards the plasma membrane after the primary cell wall, and this is known as the secondary cell. So student, this cell wall, it performs variety of functions in the plant cell. The first function of cell wall is it gave a particular cell its characteristic shape. The second function is the cell wall, it protects the plant cell from various kinds of chemical and mechanical stresses which generally exist in their environment or their habitat. This cell wall, it also prevents the entry of some undesirable macromolecules into the plant body. Besides these, this cell wall, it has special type of connections which are also present in the middle lamella, and these are known as the plasmodesmatal connections. So these plasmodesmatas or plasmodesmatal connections, which is present in the cell wall and the intermediate layer, middle lamella, it allows the movement of cytoplasm from one cell to another. That is the continuity of the cytoplasm, it remains between the two adjacent neighboring cells. So this cell wall, they act as the channels for the continuity of the cytoplasm through the plasmodesmatal connections. Now I want to tell you about the chemical composition of this cell wall. So in different type of organisms, for example in algae, the cell wall, it consists of lactans, it consists of mannose, and it consists of different type of other molecules. But in case of complex organisms such as plants, this cell wall is generally made up of cellulose, hemicellulose, and sometimes pectins and other proteins may be the constituents of this cell wall. So I have already told you that next to the cell wall, a layer is present, and that layer is known as the middle lamella. So this middle lamella, it consists of a compound of calcium, which is known as calcium pectin. So what is the function of this middle lamella? So the function of this middle lamella is, it behaves as an adhesive. It joins the two adjacent cells together by acting as a glue, or you can say an adhesive. So next to the middle lamella, what is present? Plasma membrane is present. So here the slide is visible to you. You can easily see the primary cell wall here. And then next to the primary cell wall, what is present? Middle lamella is present. So this primary cell wall, as I have already told you, it is a short-lived structure. So later it is replaced by the secondary cell wall. And this secondary cell wall, it remain in the plant cell throughout its lifespan. And then cell membrane is there, which is known as plasma membrane. And when you see inside the plasma membrane, the always a jelly-like substance is present, which is known as the protoplasm. I have already discussed that this protoplasm is actually the sum of the cytoplasm and the nucleoplasm. So many pore-like structures, which are known as plasmodesmatomes, they are present between the cell wall as well as in the middle lamellae. So through these plasmodesmatal connections, the continuity of the cytoplasm, it is maintained between the neighboring cells. So as we know that the cells, they are compactly arranged, but there are certain intercellular spaces, they are also present in the plant cells. I have already told you that in case of fungi, the plasma, the cell wall, it is made up of chitin, which is a complex type of carbohydrate. And in case of algae, so many other constituents of cell wall is there. These may be cellulose, mannose, glactans, and other type of minerals such as calcium carbonate. So this is all about the cell wall. Now the next topic is endomembrane structure. Students, as you already know, endomembrane structures are actually the term used for such organelles which have their membranes in continuity with the membrane of the nucleus or the nuclear membrane. That means those organelles comes under endomembrane structure whose membranes have a direct continuity with the outermost membrane of the nucleus. So there are four organelles which comes under endomembrane system. These are the rough endoplasmic reticulum, smooth endoplasmic reticulum, both comes under endoplasmic reticulum. Then Golgi apparatus is there, and after Golgi apparatus we have lysosomes, and then we have vacuoles. You know very well that in case of plant cell, larger vacuoles are present as compared to the animal cell because plants are autotrophic in nature. And here I'm taking the first type of the endomembrane organelle, and that is known as the endoplasmic reticulum. Before this, I want to tell you that there are some other organelles whose functions are not in a coordinated way. So these organelles cannot come under the endomembrane organelles. So endomembrane organelles are only four, and these are endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi apparatus, then we have lysosomes and vacuoles. So first endomembrane organelle is endoplasmic reticulum. As we know that depending upon the presence or absence of ribosome, these endoplasmic reticulum, they are broadly divided into two categories. They may be the rough endoplasmic reticulum, as it is visible in this diagram. Since ribosomes, they are present on the surface, so it is known as rough endoplasmic reticulum. If ribosomes are absent, then the endoplasmic reticulum is known as the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So first of all, we learn about this rough endoplasmic reticulum, which has ribosomes at their surface. So overall, I want to say that this endoplasmic reticulum, they consist of tube-like structures. And these tube-like structures, they are arranged in the form of a stack in a parallel manner. That means so many tube-like structures, they are stacked over one another in a parallel fashion. So in this way, two lumens are formed. First lumen is inside the tubular part of the endoplasmic reticulum. So this lumen-like part, which is present inside the endoplasmic reticulum, this is known as the luminal compartment. And between the two tubular structures of this endoplasmic reticulum, a space is present which contains the cytoplasm. So this place, which is outside the tubules of the endoplasmic reticulum, within the cytoplasm, they constitute the extra luminal compartment. So endoplasmic reticulum has two compartments. One is which is present inside the endoplasmic reticulum tubules, that is the luminal compartment, and the space which is present outside the luminal compartment within the cytoplasm, that is known as the extra luminal compartment. So student, if we are talking about endoplasmic reticulum, which is rough in nature, so here ribosomes are present, and these ribosomes, they play an important role in the process of protein synthesis, or you can say translation. That's why these are known as these ribosomes. Since translation takes place and proteins are formed, they are called protein factories. But what is present in smooth endoplasmic reticulum? So these smooth endoplasmic reticulum, they do not have any kind of ribosome, but they are also involved in the process of secretion. And the synthesis of lipids, or you can say fats, takes place in these. Besides fats, so many hormones which are steroidal in nature, they are also synthesized by the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So in plant cell, or you can say in animal cells, this smooth endoplasmic reticulum, especially in case of animal cell, they produce steroidal hormones. So one of the example of these steroidal hormones are testosterone hormone in case of male and estrogen hormone in case of female. So see the structure of the endoplasmic reticulum in continuity with the nuclear membrane. So in the center, this is nucleus is present, then this is a spherical body that is floating in the nucleoplasm of the nucleus known as nucleolus. The nuclear pore is present in the membrane. Then in connection with the outer membrane of the nucleus, the membrane of the endoplasmic reticulum, that means rough endoplasmic reticulum, maintain its continuity. So these are the rough endoplasmic reticulum having so many ribosomes over their surface. And these ribosomes, they do the protein synthesis. And this picture, it shows a large view of the rough endoplasmic reticulum as well as the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, students, now I'm going to tell you about the Golgi bodies. So in honor of the scientist Camillo Golgi, as he observed these structure first time in plant cell, so they are called as Golgi bodies or Golgi apparatus or dictyosome sometimes. So these Golgi bodies, they are in continuity. They have their membrane continuity with the membrane of the endoplasmic reticulum, that is with the membrane of the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So see the structure of these Golgi bodies. These Golgi bodies have flat tubule-like structures. And these tube-like structures of the Golgi bodies, they are known as cisternae. And see, all of these cisternae, they are stacked one above the another in a parallel fashion. And at their ends, and you can say at their ends or their tips, they are somewhat swollen in nature. These cisternae are somewhat swollen in nature. So this swollen portion, it is known as the lumen or vesicles. So whether these vesicles, they are attached with the cisternae of the Golgi apparatus, or sometimes they get detached from the cisternae and they move free like this, then they are known as vesicles. So these vesicles, they are secretory in nature, as one of the function of Golgi bodies is secretion. Then there are two faces of the Golgi bodies. That means there are two shapes of cisternae of the Golgi bodies. If the membrane of these cisternae, they are bulged out like the shape of a convex lens, then the face formed is known as the cis phase or the maturing phase. But if the cisternae of this Golgi apparatus, they have the shape of their face like a, you can say like a concave lens, then it is known as the transphase or the maturing phase. So cis phase or forming phase, it receives the material that comes from the smooth and rough endoplasmic reticulum. It stores it for some time and later it passes to the transphase, which is known as the maturing phase. And this maturing phase, it also stores the material for some time and later it detached from the cisternae and it forms vesicles, and these vesicles will later behave as lysosomes. And here in the lysosomization of the material takes place. So function of these Golgi bodies is, number one, they are involved in the process of secretion, and number two, they have a significant role in the packaging of the food material. That means if a rough endoplasmic reticulum, it produces proteins, and smooth endoplasmic reticulum produces steroidal hormones and lipids. So later these are shifted towards the Golgi apparatus, and the cis phase of the Golgi apparatus receive them and later transfer them towards the trans phase, and from the trans phase the vesicles they capture, and these vesicles they get attached, and later they act as the lysosomes. In this way the Golgi apparatus is in close association with the vesicles, which later behave as lysosomes. So this is all about the Golgi bodies. One thing I want to mention here is that this Golgi apparatus is the important site for the formation of glycoproteins and glycolipids. So this is a very important function. So here the glycoproteins and the glycolipids, they are also synthesized in the Golgi apparatus. So see the enlarged view of the Golgi bodies in association with the endoplasmic reticulum. So here after endoplasmic reticulum, then ribosomes, then proteins which are synthesized, the later to shifted towards the cis form phase of the Golgi apparatus, or you can say forming phase. And here it is stored in the form of vesicles. And these vesicles, they later behave as lysosome where secretion takes place. And in this way, Golgi bodies, sometimes they shifted this food material to the various intracellular target organs. And sometimes they also involved in the removal of the waste material from the body of the cell. So this is all about the function of the Golgi bodies. Okay, student, next cell organelle which comes under endomembrane system is lysosomes. So here the slide is visible to you, which shows the diagram of the lysosomes. So see, these lysosomes, they are the membrane-bound cell organelles. And these membrane-bound vesicular cell organelles, means their structure is like a vesicle. And they store the material that comes from the Golgi apparatus. So here a lipid layer is present, and a membrane is also present in the structure of the lysosome. And glycosylated membrane, it transports proteins. And later in the center of the lysosome, or you can say in the lumen of the lysosome, various hydrolytic enzymes are present for the digestion of various types of food material. For example, for carbohydrates, here so many carbohydrates enzymes are present. For lipids, lipases, and for proteins, proteases enzymes are present. So all of these hydrolytic enzymes are involved in the process of digestion of the food material. So during the course of this digestion, when this enzyme, they digest the food material, so the cell organelle lysosome, it also get consumed during the process. That's why these lysosomes, they are also known as the suicidal bag of the cell. So these enzymes, they are capable of digesting nucleic acids, carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins. So lysosomes are popularly known as suicidal bag because during the process of digestion, they are also finished, they are also consumed. That's why they are known as suicidal bags. So the next topic is vacuoles. So as we know, students, when we differentiate plant cell from animal cell, so always we said that larger vacuoles are present in case of plant cell, but they are absent in case of animal cells, or you can say somewhat smaller in size in case of animal cells. So these vacuoles, they also come under the endomembrane structures or organelles. So these vacuoles are actually the membrane bound organelles, and the membrane of the vacuole is known as the tonoplast. It is known as tonoplast. Inside the vacuole, what is present? Cell sap is present, or cytoplasm is present. So tonoplast is the outermost membrane of the vacuole, and inside it cytoplasm is there. And this vacuole, it stores variety of substances. It stores water, cell sap, excretory product which are not useful for the cell. All of these things, they are stored in these vacuoles. As I have already told you, these vacuoles, they are larger in plant cell and smaller in size in animal cells. So in plant cell, it is observed that 90% of the space of the cell is occupied by the vacuoles. They are such a larger size in case of plant cell. So here the tonoplast, it facilitates the transport of certain substances, and these substances, they enter into the cell against the concentration gradient. So in this way, in the vacuole, the concentration of these molecules is somewhat higher, and outside the cell, their concentration is low. So different type of vacuoles are present. For example, in case of amoeba, contractile vacuoles are present. And these contractile vacuoles, they are involved in the process of osmoregulation or excretion, you can say. And in case of protists, food vacuoles are there. These food vacuoles, they store the food material. And in this way, the animal, whatever the animal engulfs as its food material, that is stored in these food vacuoles. So this is all about the organelles. I have taught you four type of the cell organelles that comes under the endomembrane system. And these cell organelles are the number one, endoplasmic reticulum, number two, Golgi apparatus, number three, lysosomes, and number four, vacuoles. So this complete the endomembrane organelles. Now those organelles which cannot come under the endomembrane system because their structure as well as their function, they are not in a coordinated manner with some other organelles. So here comes the mitochondria. As we know from the previous classes, we have learned these mitochondria, they are known as the powerhouses of the cell. Why they are known as powerhouses? Because the process of cellular respiration, it takes place in the mitochondria. And as a result, large number of ATPs are produced. So that's why they are known as the powerhouse of the cell. So here we are going to study about its structure. So this mitochondria, it has variety of shape. So here it may have sausage shape, it may have spherical shape. And accordingly, the size of the mitochondria, it also varies. Cylindrical shape of mitochondria is also there. And if we are talking about the membranes, so two membranes are present in the mitochondria, the outermost membrane and the inner membrane. The outermost membrane is somewhat continuous in nature. Whereas the innermost membrane, it is in the form of infoldings. So many folds of the innermost membrane are there. And in this way, both of these membranes, they divide the mitochondrion into two compartments, outer compartment and the inner compartment. So the inner compartment of the mitochondria, it also contains a semi-fluid homogeneous dense matrix. And inside this dense matrix, what is present that I will tell you soon. Before they see the structure of the diagram of the mitochondria here, this is the outer membrane. Then this is the fold of the inner membrane. The fold of this inner membrane is known as crista or cristae. So here a space is present between the two membranes. This is known as the intermembrane space. Then inside the inner membrane, some particles are attached in a hanging fashion. And these particles, they have a head-like structure and a small stalk-like structure. And these structures, these hanging structures which are attached with the infoldings of the cristae, they are known as the F0, F1 particles. So it is believed that in these F0, F1 particles, an enzyme lives, which is the ATP synthesizing enzyme ATPase. And this enzyme, during the process of cellular respiration, it synthesizes ATP. And in this way, during the process of aerobic respiration or cellular respiration, 36 ATPs are generally produced, and which is a large amount of ATPs. That's why mitochondria are known as the powerhouses of this. So the process of aerobic respiration, it takes place inside the innermost membrane within the matrix. A little bit I want to tell you more about the mitochondria, that these mitochondria, they are the semi-autonomous organelles since they have their own DNA. They have a single circular DNA, some ribosomes are also there, some RNAs are also there. So because of these mitochondria, they can also synthesize their proteins with the help of these ribosomes. That's why they are known as the semi-autonomous organelles. And what about the process of their division? So these mitochondria, they divide by the process of fission during the cell division. So in this way, mitochondria, they are donated by the parent cell to the daughter cells. So this is all about mitochondria. So see the diagram, ribosomes are there, matrix is present in the inner compartment, then outer membrane, inner membrane, intermembranal space, then F0F1 particles which are attached with the innermost membrane crista. Then DNA is also present in the mitochondria, that's why they are semi-autonomously rich. So after this, I am going to tell you about a very special organelle, cell organelle that is present in the plant cell. And this cell organelle is known as plastids. So as we know, plastids, they are always related with the storage of some substances that are very much required for the process of photosynthesis. And because of this, the plants, they act as autotrophs. So here you see the diagram of these plastids. So what is present in a plastid that we will study in detail. Now, first of all, I want to tell you these plastids are not only present in the plant cell, but they are also present in the euglenoids. The chief representative member of euglenoids is euglenin. So here, these plastids, they are of different types, depending upon what kind of substances they store. For example, they may be chloroplast, they may be chromoplast, or they may be leucoplast, depending upon what substances they have stored inside. So first of all, chloroplast, as the name itself indicates, this type of plastids, they store a green color pigment known as chlorophyll. And this green color pigment chlorophyll, it traps sun's energy for the process of photosynthesis. So the second type of plastids, they are known as the chromoplast. So beside chlorophyll, there are so many other type of pigments which impart characteristic color to the plant cells. So these pigments may be xanthophylls, carotenoids, and these pigments, they provide red, yellow, and violet, and this different type of colors, purple color to the plant cells. So all of these pigments are stored in the chromoplast, which is the second type of plastid. And the third type of plastids, they are somewhat colorless in nature, and they are known as the leucoplast. So these leucoplasts, they generally store oil, starch, this type of substances, and they are further categorized into three subcategories. Number one, amyloplast. Amyloplast, generally they store starch, and they are found in case of potatoes. And then we have elaioplast. So this elaioplast, it stores oils and fats. And then we have alluroplast. So these alluroplast, they store proteins. That's all about the types of plastids. So after this, we will study about a very special type of plastid. And before this, I want to tell you that the number of these plastids, they may vary in different type of cell. For example, in case of an algae, Chlamydomonas, a single chloroplast is there. But if we are talking about the mesophyll cells of the green algae, some other complex green algae, so this number, it may be varied. It may be 20 to 40 and so on. So in this way, as we have already discussed, as mitochondria is a semi-autonomous organelle, so here the chloroplast or the plastids, they are also semi-autonomic in nature. And these also consist of two membranes, as it is visible to you in this diagram. So outer membrane and the inner membrane. And the inner membrane is somewhat less permeable in nature. And between the external membrane and the internal membrane, there is a space present, which is known as the intermembrane space. And when you see under the intermembrane, you can say internal membrane. So there is a ground matrix present, and this ground fluid-like substance, which is present inside the lumen of the chloroplast, within the inner membrane, it is known as stroma. So this stroma is very much important because some of the important plant reactions, they are taking place with the, which are related with photosynthesis, that we will study in the chapter of photosynthesis. So here so many other structures are also found. So these spherical structures, which are stacked one above the another, the single portion of these stacked like structures is known as thallophyte. and a group of thalacoids, which are arranged in the form of a coins, piles of coins. They are known as grana. So many granas they are suspended in the stroma of the chloroplast. And all of these granas, which are actually the group of thalacoids, so adjacent granas, they are also attached with the help of membranous tubule-like structures. And these tubule-like structures or membranous structures which connect the thalacoids of one grana with the thalacoids of the other grana, they are known as the stroma lamellae. So in this way, so many granas in the form of piles of coins, they are present in the stroma of the chloroplast. And chloroplast, it also have their own DNA because it is semi-autonomic in nature. And ribosomes are also there for the process of protein synthesis. And different type of enzymes for the synthesis of carbohydrates, proteins are also present here in the chloroplast. So besides these ribosomes which are present in the chloroplast, they are actually the 70S ribosomes, which are somewhat smaller in size than the eukaryotic ribosomes, which are 80S. I will tell you more about ribosomes later on. So I hope this structure of chloroplast and the types of chloroplast, it is very much clear to you. So read the chapter up to chloroplast and find out the questions regarding these topics. And that's all in today's lecture. So have a nice day.